Hello. So we are back and we're going to go on a bit of a tangent today. We're going to break away from the Wi-Fi stuff. Just need a bit of a personal break from that and do something that will be useful for the future and that we will certainly need. So at the moment we're running FreeRTOS, of course, so we've got all these different tasks running. Imagine our project's bigger than this, and it eventually will be. We need a way of communicating between these tasks that is a bit safer than just passing around heap pointers and hoping that the receiving task actually gets it and frees that memory. Very quick and easy way to get a memory leak. So the way FreeRTOS does this is by using queues, and that's the way we're going to do it. I'm quite familiar with FreeRTOS queues, so we're going to implement our own task messaging class that will allow us to use the FreeRTOS queues, but in our nice C++ environment. In the object-oriented way rather than FreeRTOS's C functional way. So let's make ourselves a new folder. We'll call it task messaging for no particular good reason. And we'll see if we can do this as a header only as well. That would be nice. Anyone who's been scouting around on the GitHub will notice a new branch called Future, and this is where I'm testing out ideas, trying to just get a bit ahead of the game compared to what I'm recording, so I can test things out and make sure I'm not doing something completely stupid and wasting everyone's time. So, usual thing, we'll do a pragma once. See earlier debates on whether you should use define guards or pragma once, but there we go, that's what we're using. We're going to need to include FreeRTOS, include, and that is in the FreeRTOS folder, and it's called FreeRTOS.h, like that. And we're going to need to include task.h as well. We might not actually need task.h. We probably will need q.h. Let me just see. Can I open copy relative reveal in file explorer? That's what I want to do. Is there a q.h or have I completely made that up? Is it in task? No, there is a q.h. Yeah, I don't think we'll need task.h. We'll find out soon enough. ESP event we don't need yet, but we might need in the future. I'm gonna just include some other utility things. So we'll include the C assert, and we're gonna use smart pointers for this as well. So this will be our first little dip into smart pointers. And I'll explain when we get there why we're using a smart pointer. Obviously, we could roll our own, that's fine, but what's the point? And we'll include utility as well for our locks. Okay, cool. These will become apparent shortly. So let's create ourselves a namespace just to keep everything clean. Bear with me, two ticks. That's not what I wanted. That's what I wanted. And just bear with me a sec. Sorry, just had to send a quick email there. Lovely, right. So we've got ourselves a namespace. Let's do this again, top down. I like the top-down approach. I think it always pays for itself. So we're going to want some sort of interface. So we'll call it queue interface. And for some reason on my branch, I put underscore T on the end of this, which is a bit naughty. You shouldn't do that, so we won't do that. And we're going to obviously have a public interface. Now, FreeRTOS queues, let's talk about them. Basically, it's an array, for want of a better word, of items that you can post, and the item is whatever size of that item, struct, class, int, a bool, whatever, it doesn't really matter. And it has a certain length, so a queue length, you can have five items in this queue, or one item in this queue, so on and so forth. So they're things that we're going to need to know. So let's put that in straight away then. Let's do something like, so we'll have a const, because the queue length and so on isn't going to change. Size T, to be our device specific thing. And we'll have a queue length, which will be default initialized to zero. And we'll have an item size in bytes, which we'll just default initialize. We'll initialize those in the constructor anyway, so it doesn't really matter. And that doesn't really change anything, but is a little bit more clear, I guess. So we're going to need a send and a receive. So we're gonna go through this at some rate of knots. So hopefully that's all okay with everyone. So we'll return an error type and we'll have a send. We'll have a receive. What else do we need? Let me just tidy up this. Why I don't particularly like having notes, because there's long pauses in the video then and you're wondering what I'm doing. We'll have a peek for reasons that will become apparent later. We might want to know how many items are in the queue waiting to be read. So that will return a size T, n items waiting. I'll just take a void for now. And then conversely, we'll want to probably know how many free spaces we've got. And then probably just a couple of helper functions. So bool empty. And we'll have another one for full. Keeping that in line with the standard library. Personally, I would prefer is empty, but we'll keep it in line with the standard library. Because it gets confusing with a clear function. So the way the standard library does it is clear will empty something, reset it all to default initialized effectively. So if you clear a string, it effectively deletes the contents of the string. Empty doesn't empty the string. It's not the same as clear. It tells you whether or not the current object holds any data. So in this case, whether or not they're... So in fact, we can actually do these straight off the bat. We can implement these, so this will be a const function, and it's simply going to return this n items remaining is equal to zero, because it's returning a bool. So if there are no items waiting, then clearly the queue is empty, and full is not too dissimilar, where It will be the number of items waiting is equal to the queue length. Or the other way we can do it is the number of free spaces is equal to zero, which probably makes a bit more sense. The effectively will mean the same thing, but there we go. There's one other type of send we might want to do, which is send to front. So by default, when you send stuff to a queue in FreeRTOS, it puts it at the end of the queue. So it's first in, first out. But sometimes you want to circumvent that and say, no, this is a higher priority message than anything that's potentially sat in the queue. I want you to service this next. So that will push the item to the front of the queue and move anything else that was in the queue back one. And that's probably our interface, which we'll probably do for now. So what are we sending? Well, we're going to be sending some sort of item. What's the item? Well, it depends what the queue is. It could be a queue of ints, a queue of bools, a queue of structs, classes, whatever. So you can probably see where this is going. These need to be templated. And we'll just do type name T. And we'll pass it in by reference. And we'll call it item. And that's going to be very, well, practically the same here for all of these. So we'll do copy, copy, copy. This is a send, so this can be a const, oops, a const reference, effectively promising not to change the item we were passed, so we'll do it by copy, is what we're saying there. And logically the same here. So we're promising not to change the underlying item that's sent so it can be reused by the caller later down the line. And we're going to need a couple of other bits and bobs, so a couple of member variables. So these can be protected. We're going to need some sort of mutex to ensure that two people aren't trying to send to the queue at the same time, and equally for receive. Now, the way we've structured this, there's a good chance that some of these functions are going to call themselves. So to that end, we can't use a standard mutex because if we've already obtained the mutex and then call one of the other functions, the mutex is already taken, so it would break things. So I think we briefly talked about this in an earlier video. We actually need a recursive mutex. So that allows you to take the mutex multiple times as long as you are the same calling task. If you're a different task, then you will be blocked. And we'll have one of those for receive as well. So we've got a send mutex and a receive mutex. We'll default initialize those. This is largely superfluous in C++ 17, might have been 11, where everything is guaranteed to be default initialized, but I like doing it. It's just my preference. Now, if we think about this conceptually, we're going to have some sort of queue, and multiple tasks are going to want access to this queue, but we only want one underlying queue in that case. So you've got a sending task and a receiving task, for example. So we're going to want to copy this object because both might want to send and both might want to receive, but we don't want to copy the underlying FreeRTOS queue. So this is where we're going to use a shared pointer. So it's a standard shared putter. Forget the guy I was watching on YouTube the other day who called it a putter. And let's just align those. And it'll be a handle to a queue. Now, shared pointer is a template. So we'll come back and fill that in a moment. So let's actually do some of the implementation here, because the interface is largely, well, it's going to be the same regardless because we've got these templates here. I've done it this way rather than making the whole class a template. Both are valid, to be honest, but I think this way looks a little bit cleaner. So let's do send first of all, and we'll use, rather than lock guard, we'll use a scoped lock. Effectively, it does exactly the same thing. You'll see why I'm using a scope lock later on. It basically allows you to obtain more than one lock at once. More than one mutex at once. So we'll just call this the guard. And this is send, so we'll get the send mutex. Something like that. Did I put an underscore on it? Yes, I did. So we've got the mutex now. So let's think about this logically. If the queue is not full, and we've already got a full thing here, so if it's not full, then we will send something to the queue. If it is full, we will return ESP error no mem. Not strictly no memory, but we'll get the implication from that. There's no space in the queue. Otherwise, we can actually send the item. So we can do if, and the FreeRTOS function returns PD pass if the item was sent, and the function is xq send, and we'll fill out the parameters in a minute, and if it passed, then we can return ESP OK. Otherwise, we'll just return ESP fail for now. Now, here, the first parameter is the actual pointer to the queue, so we'll fill that out in a moment. The next parameter is the thing that you want to post to the queue, which in this case is the item, but we need to pass a pointer to the item, so we'll do and to take the address. And hopefully we won't get a const violation here. I don't think we will, because xqsend does by copy. And then the third parameter is how long we want to sit and wait for a space to be available. Well, it makes no sense because we've already checked that there is a space. So, and we've got the guard. The lock, should I say, so no one else can be sending at the same time. So if it's not full, then clearly there's space. So we can just put don't wait, just post it straight away. So the pointer to the actual underlying queue, well, we've got a shared pointer here to the queue, but we actually need to get the underlying pointer because xqsend won't take a shared pointer. So if you look at the CPP reference, what we're actually calling is hq.get, and that returns the underlying pointer, not as a shared pointer. So dangerous function, but here that this is the intended use case for that get. So that's our send function actually done already. And regardless of what type we pass, what the item is, whether it's an int, a struct, class, so on and so forth, we don't care. We just want the address of it. We don't even need to pass a length because xqsend will look at the queue and go, well, the queue is full of items that are of a specific length, therefore this must be that length, so we don't need to pass it as an additional parameter. And it's as simple as that. Center front is very, very similar, but there's just a different FreeRTOS call. So we can copy and paste these. Worth mentioning, none of these functions that are showing you can be called from an interrupt service routine, an ISR. We will implement that separately. But the FreeRTOS call to center the front is xqcenter front, and there's some flavor text there. It's all in the FreeRTOS documentation. Apart from that, it's all the same. Nice and easy peasy. It's two functions done already. Love the top-down way of doing things. It's really, really good. We can do receive now. So we'll do, if I just pop that up, get rid of that. We want our scoped lock, as usual, to ensure no one else is receiving at the same time. So we need to change that to the receive mutex. And actually, the implementation is going to be very, very similar. So let's just copy and paste that in, except this time it'll be if not empty. So if there is something in the queue, and no mem doesn't quite make as much sense here. There's a better ESP error message. We can use not found because there was nothing found in the queue. Someone's called receive an item from the queue, but there isn't anything, so we didn't find anything. So that one makes a little bit more sense. And here, rather than send, unsurprisingly, it's xqreceive. Receive, there we go. It's the same thing here. We're passing in somewhere to store the item. We're passing in the pointer, the handle to the queue. But here we might actually want to wait. We might want to have a blocking call. A task may say, well, I just want to sit and wait for the next message to come in, and I don't need to do anything else until then. So we need to add an extra parameter on here. And it's going to take the tick type, and we'll call it wait ticks. Zero is perfectly valid. It will just immediately return if it's empty, but of course we know it's not empty at this point. What I've just said now makes no sense because we're checking if it's empty. So actually, no, I'm chatting rubbish. That makes no sense whatsoever. Because we would never actually get to this call, so we might as well put zero. Yeah, that makes sense. Oh, good. Nice little bit of ill logic there in my notes. Now, peak is quite useful. Peak is effectively a receive, however, the difference being it does not remove the item from the queue. So if there's something in the queue, we get that item and then it is cleared from the queue. So if there was one item, we receive that item. Now the queue is empty. There are occasions where you may want to get the item but leave it in the queue. So we'll implement that now. And unsurprisingly, it's going to be very, very similar to receive. But the call is slightly different. It's, of course, xqpeak, and everything else is the same. So we've already got our implementation, our interface, and most of our implementation done here. We need to fill out a few bits. So our queue, we need to make sure this queue is valid. So the shared pointer holds a pointer to a queue or a queue handle, a FreeRTOS queue handle, and that is not null. So before we actually implement this, we need one more function call here to check whether or not the queue is valid. And we may as well do that with an operator. And I don't think we've done the operator bool yet. But this is quite handy. And it looks a bit weird. It's const because we're not changing the state of the underlying object. And we do return HQ. True or false. So what we're doing here, we are doing a comparison, or we're actually calling the bool operator of the shared pointer. Let's collapse some of these. So shared pointer has its own operator bool. So if you do equals true or false on this, double equals true or false on this, it will return true if the underlying pointer is valid or false otherwise. So that's why we have to use this ternary operator. If we just return HQ, it doesn't call the comparison, the bool operator. It would return the shared pointer. That's not what we want here. So we have to use some sort of comparison here. I'll just use a ternary. You could do this with if else as well. That would equally work. But this, by doing it this way, it calls the bool operator. You can also do dot operator bool as well and call it as like a function call, but that looks a bit messy for this particular operator. So we'll just do a ternary like this. This will get optimized away anyway, so we're not too bothered. So now, because we've created our own bool operator for queue interface, now if we do if queue interface or an object of, then it will tell us straight away whether or not the underlying queue in the shared pointer is valid, and that's really all we care about. So we're effectively cascading the bool operator from the shared pointer through to our object. So let's go back and look at this. Is something missing? Well, yes, actually, now we've done this, something is missing. We don't want to try and send to the queue or even check if the queue is full if the queue is invalid. We're essentially checking for null pointer here. So we want to do if something, if the queue is valid, then do this. Otherwise, return ESP error invalid state is what we'll use for this. But what do we put in here? We want to call this operator. We know how to do it like that, but we're talking about an object of the thing we're currently in. So that's where we use the this pointer, which refers to the objects we're currently talking about, but we need to, but this is a pointer, so we need to dereference it. So if we dereference the this pointer, we actually get the object, and we're doing an if on it, so we're calling the bool operator, which will return true if the underlying queue is valid. So a bit of logic there, dereference the this pointer, we call the bool operator because we're doing an if on it. So if the un so this basically says if HQ, so it's equivalent to doing that. So if the queue is valid, or if HQ is not equal to false, or another way of putting it, HQ.get to get the underlying pointer is not a null pointer. These are all equivalent ways of doing exactly the same thing. Personally, I think that looks cleaner. So if our object is valid, then we'll go ahead and do the rest of the code. I think that looks a lot neater. And it also means that we can actually add extra stuff in here. So if we extend this interface to do more things, we might want to check if not only the queue is valid, but something else is valid as well. At this moment, we don't have that, but it gives us the opportunity to do that without then needing to change a load of if statements. So let's cascade that down, because we need the same logic for all of our senders and receivers. Again, no point trying to receive from a queue if the queue doesn't exist. And we'll keep things common, return invalid state. So last one here, and we'll copy if this. There we are. So now we're protected if for whatever reason the queue is invalid, wasn't constructed properly, or something's gone very wrong. So last thing to do in the something missing. We've got a bunch of question marks here. What is the type of the underlying pointer within shared pointer? Well, we can get a hint towards that if we hover over this. That's a hash define, so never mind. If we just go to one of the functions, it's a queue handle. And that is the type of the underlying pointer that is being managed by our shared putter. However, there is a problem with this, and there's a hint on the screen here. What is the type qHandle_T? What is its primitive type? I'll just pause, let you have a look at that. So here's the definition of qHandle type. Type def void star qhandle type. So qhandle t, its primitive type in the language is a void star. That's really bad. I'm not even sure if shared pointer will allow you to create a shared pointer to a void star. Personally, I don't even want to try it. So that's effectively what we're writing here. That's not good. We don't want a shared pointer to a void star. In fact, we want to avoid void stars altogether. Wherever possible, they are unbelievably dangerous to use. But we can also see that actually what FreeRTOS have done is they've got a struct that's called a queue definition. And a queue handle is a pointer to this struct, or an instance of this struct. But they pass it around as a void star because it's easier, rather than passing it as a queue definition star, which is what it would be. But that means that this points to an object of type queue definition. So therefore, rather than using void star, we can actually use queue definition. So the shared pointer is a shared pointer to a queue definition. Note, you don't need the star here, because that would then be, and if you look at the shared pointer documentation, this would be a shared pointer to a queue definition star. That's not what we want, so this would be a star then, a pointer to a pointer. No, we want a shared pointer to an object that is a queue definition. So beat about the bush there. Explained that in much the hardest possible way. But we actually want the underlying struct, because it's that we care about is valid or not. So that's our shared pointer. That's our implementation done. The last thing we need to do is actually to create the queue itself, to actually allocate the memory for the queue. And that's using a call called xqcreate, unsurprisingly, and that does all the dynamic allocations for us. We're not going to do that in the interface for reasons that will become apparent. But we do need to do our constructor here because we've got something to think about with the shared pointer. So let's do our constructor. And this can live here after this, I think. So we'll do Q interface face like that. And we have some consts that we need to initialize. So Q UE len is a const, so we need to initialize that. We've got item size bytes, which we need to initialize. Let's just give IntelliSense a chance. Oh, we need to implement these as well. We'll do that afterwards. And we have HQ that we're going to need to initialize as well. It's not a const, but we do need to initialize it. Now, as I say, we are not going to create the queue in this class. So therefore, it must be passed to the class, and in this case, in the constructor. So we will take a standard shared putter. Would that make more sense being a unique pointer? Yeah, it would. So it's going to take a unique pointer to a queue definition. So that guarantees, well, sort of guarantees that there's only one owner of this. And we'll just call it HQ, because then that means we can pass that into there. And what we're effectively doing there is we are creating a shared pointer from a unique pointer. Can you do that? Is a good question. CPP reference shared putter. Let's have a quick look-see. We want the constructor. C++17. So it can take, can it take a unique pointer? Yes, it can. So number 12 we want, sorry, this is super small on your screen, constructs a shared pointer which manages the objects currently managed by R, which is the unique pointer, and there's a deleter in there as well. So it's going to do a standard move effectively, and then the unique pointer becomes empty. Right, okay, that's good. That's exactly what we want. Is it what we want? Yes, I think it is what we want, actually. That does seem to make sense. We can always come back and change it, but I'm pretty sure that is what I want. And I'm just going to copy and paste in from my notes the other two parameters, because they're fairly obvious. We need the number of items that we want this queue, that this queue currently holds, actually. And then how big each item is in bytes, because we need knowledge of that. In fact, do we? Technically, we don't. But it's It's going to be the same for any derived class anyway, so it makes sense to be in this base class, for want of a better word. Yes, the base is the interface. I know that's a bit of a backwards way of doing it, but it's what we're going to do. Let's do it simple. Now we do need a copy constructor. Why? Well, we sort of explained this before. What if we have a queue? We've created a queue, we've created an object, and that is going to one class is going to own that. Sorry, another object's going to own that. So say our Wi-Fi is going to own that for receiving data that we want to send over Wi-Fi. We need a copy to the same queue that we can give to our GPIO, for example, that's reading the state of a pin and then is sending that state through the queue, which then appears back at Wi-Fi. So we actually need two copies of the queue, but they need to be linked copies effectively. So we'll call this our constructor. Our normal constructor, and then this will be our copy constructor. Still need to go back and put in some comments through through this project. And the way we define a copy constructor is it's const, so we don't modify the incoming thing. And we pass it in by reference. And the typical way is just to call it other. And what do we want to initialize our class to? Well, we just want other.nItems, other.itemNBytes, and other.hq. Now, this is clever. So, what is happening here? Other.hq is a valid share, well, is a shared pointer to the underlying queue. So when we initialize this instance, which is a new object, HQ doesn't get passed a unique pointer like it did here. It's now being passed a shared pointer. And what that does, if you read the CPP reference, is it doesn't create a new underlying object, so it won't create a new queue definition. What it will do is it will use the existing one, but increase our number of users from one to two. So it will just plus plus it. So now the shared pointer, both shared pointers know that two objects are using this underlying queue definition. So if one gets deleted, what the shared pointer does is it looks, says, is anyone else using this? If so, I won't delete it. However, if no one else is using it, then the underlying queue definition here can be deleted or freed because there's no other users. No one else has a shared pointer to this. I am the last user, so in effect, I'm now unique. So that makes the copy constructor really, really easy to do. However, it we probably want to put some asserts in here. Do we want to put some asserts in here? No, we don't. I'm chatting rubbish. We don't. We want to put asserts in this one. And what do we want to assert? Well, the things that shouldn't happen but could. Number of items. If the number of items is zero, or hang on a minute. So if zero is less than the number of items, so it's equivalent to doing n items is greater than zero. I just like putting consts first. In this case, they're both cons, so it doesn't really matter. But means the same thing. So if we've said I want a queue of zero items, that makes no sense whatsoever. So we can just do an assert on there. Technically, we don't really need that because we can do it when we actually create the queue. And the other one is fairly obvious. I'm just going to inline it here. If the size of the item is zero, so an empty class, that makes no sense. Well, empty classes can be useful, but in this context, it wouldn't be. So we'll just do an assert on that. We may end up getting rid of these or moving them somewhere else, because they might get a bit janky to do review this. There we go. And because this is our main constructor, we don't have to do any asserts in the copy constructor, because nItems and itemsNBytes here must have passed this assert for this to be constructed, unless somewhere we called QInterface with no parameters. So QInterface, just putting some sudo code here, and we said no parameters, so we default constructed it. Now we should get a compile time warning because because we've got consts that, in fact, no, we won't, because we're initializing them here. So this would cause us a problem if this was in our code somewhere else. So we need to actually delete the default constructor, because it makes no sense to default construct this class. There's other work to do. So we can just do equals delete, which covers that quite nicely. So not default constructible. And programmer, I can't spell. Okay, so everything is here now that we need, bar some nice code comments. Oh no, we needed to do these two, didn't we? Yeah, said we'd come back to that. So let's do this one first. Number of items waiting in the queue. We probably want to get both mutexes here, because if someone's currently writing to the queue, it sort of makes sense to wait for them to finish writing to the queue and then return that number of items. Otherwise, we might get out of step. So scoped lock, and we'll just call it guard. NItems waiting can be const as well, because we're not changing any states. We are, but we'll discuss that in a moment. And we want to take the send mutex, and this is why I'm using scoped lock, because we can pass in more than one mutex. So now we won't progress past this line until we've got both mutexes. And what we're going to do is, if dereference this, so if the queue is valid, we will return something. Otherwise, well, we're returning size t, so if the queue is not valid, it's sort of implicitly empty. So we'll do that. Now there's a free RTOS call here that we can use, ux unsigned integer queue messages waiting, and you can look that up in the documentation. And the only parameter this takes is a handle to the queue, and we know how to do that. QUEUE.get, simple as that. So if the queue is valid, return the number of items in the queue. Could be zero. Otherwise, just return zero. We're not returning an ESP error type here. There's not really a huge amount of point. We could, but then we would have to pass in a value by reference, and sometimes we just don't want to do that. You know, you just want to get the number of items. So for this, that is absolutely fine. And unsurprisingly, n free spaces is going to be almost exactly the same, but rather than messages waiting, it's the FreeRTOS call is spaces available. Again, what we could do here is number of items waiting, sorry, length of the queue minus number of items waiting, that would do the same thing. But that probably looks better. And this can be const as well, because it's not changing the state. However, it is. We are changing that mutex and that mutex because we are taking them. So we are changing the state of these two mutexes. So at the moment, this won't compile with const there, because you're not allowed to make changes to the object in a const function. However, it does still make sense for these to be const. And the way we get around this is another keyword, and personally not my favorite, is we make the mutexes mutable. What does that mean? Well, not a lot really. All it means is that a const function is allowed to mutate, change, these two variables. Even though it's a const function, we're saying, no, you're allowed to change these two, but only these two, only things with mutable. So it's not allowed to change the state of this shared pointer, because this is not mutable. We could make it mutable, but then if everything in the class is mutable, then there's no point in having const on everything. Sort of defeats the whole purpose. And here, empty is a const function, and it is allowed to call nItemsWaiting because this is a const function. If this wasn't const, then neither could this be, because you're not allowed to call non-const functions from another const function, unless, again, this was mutable. But then it was starting to get silly, and that makes no sense. So this is the way I think looks cleaner and makes more sense. And what you would actually see in a lot of code is mutexes are very often marked mutable, whereas the underlying data is not. It's sort of logical, really. So that's our interface. The only thing left... Oh, no, we haven't done clear, have we? So actually clear is going to be very, very similar. So I'm just going to copy this down, just save me typing loads of stuff out again. So we're going to get a lock. We want to get both locks, the send and the receive, because we don't want to clear it while someone's reading it. And equally, we don't want to clear it if someone's currently writing to it. So we'll make sure we're the only one doing anything here. We'll make sure the queue is valid. And then we need to return xQReset. So xQReset resets a queue back to its original empty state. The return value is now obsolete and it is always set to PD pass. So this is largely superfluous. But if it returns pass, so it successfully reset the queue, which it's always going to do, but given that note. But if it is, we'll return true. If anything else went wrong, so if for some reason the implementation of this changed, and the queue wasn't reset, or if the queue is not valid, will return false. And that seems reasonably logical there. So that's all we need to do for clear. So now, finally, the only thing that's left is we actually need to create and destroy the queue. The reason I'm not doing it in this class is because there's actually two types of queues in FreeRTOS. There's static queues and there's dynamic queues. And basically the only difference is where the memory is allocated. One is allocated on, well, either the stack or in static memory. And then a dynamic one is allocated on the heap. Pros and cons to both. So we want to implement both because some, we might just want a queue for a few function calls and then get rid of it. So we might want a dynamic queue on the heap for that. Don't really care. And there's others that are pretty much going to exist for the lifetime of the program. So it would be nice if we could allocate those statically. So the compiler can allocate them or they're allocated on the stack. It's just a little bit safer, less fragmentation of heap memory and so on and so forth. So we're going to have two types. We're going to have a dynamic queue. Dynamic queue. And we're going to have a static queue. And both of them will inherit publicly the queue interface. So they get all the functionality of the queue interface. So there's our dynamic queue, and here is our static queue. Now, the way I've done this in my notes, static isn't strictly correct, but we'll discuss that when we come to it. What are we on, 56 minutes? Yeah, we'll get this done. There's very, very little left to do. So we'll get this done in this episode now. So let's do the dynamic queue. This is the more common one here. I've just thought maybe these constructors should be protected. Yeah, I'm going to move these down. Because we don't want anyone constructing an object of this type. It sort of wouldn't make sense. Yeah. So you can only construct it through inheritance. Yeah, that makes sense. Happy with that. Yeah. Happy with that. Cool. So this is going to have the public constructor, which is going to take some things and do some stuff. And we'll have some private functions to actually do the creating. So the FreeRTOS call we want, I'm just going to copy and paste this in, is xqcreate. And it takes the number of items you want the queue to hold and the size of each item. And if I just F12 into this, we can see it returns a queue handle, which we know is should be a queue definition star. But queue handle is okay. So we know that this function is going to return a queue handle. And we'll call it create queue, and it's going to take some parameters that we don't quite know yet. So that's actually the implementation, and to be honest, we know what the parameters are. It's these two things. Const size t, so, and the number of bytes. And they just get passed straight down. This will get inlined by the compiler. But anyway, it's nice and clear. And if we wanted to do other things when we create the queue, we can just insert it into this function, nice and easy. We also want to be able to delete this queue. And the function call we want for that is vqdelete. It's got V at the start, so it returns a void. So that means this function makes sense to return a void. We could return a bool and set it to always true, but what's the point in having return value if it doesn't mean anything? And we're going to do something a little bit odd here, but all will become apparent because I've implemented this in a... I'm really proud of it. I think it's really clever. But we'll call this delete queue. And weirdly, it might look a bit weird, we're going to pass in the queue handle, which we'll just call h, and we'll pass that to vqueue delete. Now you might say, well, why am I passing it in? I know what it is because it's in my shared pointer. I could just use hq.get. And that would make perfect sense. However, we're doing it this way and it will become apparent very soon. Now, we do want to protect this. We don't want delete getting called while someone else is reading or while someone else is sending to the queue. So we do need to protect it with, a scoped lock, and we'll take both mutexes to make sure no one else is trying to send or receive. Then the queue will get deleted. Now, this is where the clever bit comes in. We need to create the unique pointer that we pass to the constructor here. Because if we look at our dynamic queue constructor, we need to initialize the base class, this. So we need to pass it, and we know what we need to pass it, either an already valid base object or a unique pointer, the number of items and the number of bytes. So we already know what this needs to take. So that is question marks, but size and items is actually needs to be passed in by the caller, whoever's creating this object. So then we can actually just get rid of these two like that. But we still need to create this unique pointer. We can create a queue handle, so we're almost there. But we need to do some clever here. I'm going to abstract this out into a function. The function will return a standard unique pointer to a queue definition. We've already talked about that. And we'll call it create queue unique putter. And it's clearly it's going to have to call this, so we also need to pass in these same two items as well. That's gone off the screen. That's the wrong button, that one, like that. There we go. So we'll pass those in. So how do we create a unique pointer? Now typically you would use standard make unique. This is the efficient way of doing it, and then you pass in whatever your parameters are. Unfortunately, we can't do it that way because when the pointer gets deleted, we actually need to do more than just call delete hq.get effectively. We need to do more than just deleting the queue like that. We need to call this function, which in turn calls this and does the lock guard and everything. So we can't actually use make unique, which is annoying. And there's some great videos on YouTube and so on why you should use make unique rather than doing it this way. But in this case, make unique doesn't work if you've got a custom deleter. So we have to do it the other way, which is the more sort of typical way compared to other things you would do, but not typical for smart pointers. So what we want to do is create a standard unique pointer. And let's just do this sort of textually first, pointer. And it is going to take, first of all, the function that we need to call, or the thing that we need to do to create the queue definition. And the way we do that is by calling create queue. And we pass in n items and n bytes from up here. So that tells the unique pointer how to make the underlying object. So calling xQcreate effectively. Now the second parameter tells unique pointer what to do when it destroys the item. So this is why you can't use make unique, because you can't add this second parameter in. And what we want to do is call delete queue with the pointer as an argument that unique pointer currently holds. But H doesn't exist. We don't have access to that because, well, we've not created it yet. So how we do it is through a lambda. So there's our lambda. We're going to capture this so we have access to the delete queue method there. We can use auto, and you'll see me very seldom use auto. And then the actual lambda body we'll call delete QH. So now we've defined a nameless function, i.e. a lambda in this case, that calls delete Q with parameter H. And the way that the smart pointers work is the deleter gets called by a function pointer with parameter, which is the underlying pointer. That sort of made no sense, but hopefully, read CPP reference, it sort of shows you this, and it is very, very odd, sort of makes sense. So that's the function that we need to do to create the pointer, and that's the function we need to do to delete the pointer, as we've implemented up here. Now this is, we don't need this, because we can do, it can be deduced from the return type. So we can just straight up return. We could, if I could spell it, return and then we can just pass it to an initializer list like that. Doesn't, I must say, it doesn't look as nice. And then of course we need the semicolon at the end. So we are returning something that takes that and that as parameters. The compiler will look and see, well, what are you returning? Oh, you're returning a standard unique pointer. So I will create a unique pointer from this initializer list. And that's that, actually pretty much done. So if we remember, our interface constructor takes a unique pointer. We now can construct that, and we can actually do this in the constructor here. So we can call create unique pointer with n items and, unsurprisingly, n bytes. And oh, hello. What have I done there? That needs to be in brackets. Yeah, there we go. So we just call that straight in the parameter list here. So that'll call this function, which then in turn calls create queue, and saves in the shared pointer how to delete it as well if we become the last user. And of course, this gets promoted into a shared pointer in the interface anyway. So hopefully that makes a bit of sense. So now if we create a dynamic queue, so somewhere in our code, we have my queue and we pass it, I want the queue to be of length 1 and it's going to hold an int. And now what will happen is the queue will get created and we'll get an instance of dynamic queue, which we can copy. So my queue, let's call it my queue in. And then we want another variable, which is my queue out, which we'll pass to a completely different object, which will take my queue in. And then these two things will be linked because we've called the copy constructor. So it'll create another shared pointer, but to the same underlying queue. All the other data, you know, the size of the item and so on is all the same. So we'll have these two objects that we can move to where they need to go. So hopefully that sort of makes sense why we're doing it this way. So last thing then is to do the static one. So say if we want to create this statically in the static memory or on the stack, so not on the heap. There's a few more considerations to this. I'm going to show you what I've done so far, but I still need to have a head scratch, and this is where you guys come in to put your comments down below as to where this won't work and what potential bugs we can foresee. I've already spotted a couple, but I might give you a teaser. So very, very similar to dynamic queue, so much so I am literally going to copy and paste this down and then we'll edit it as we see fit. Whoops-a-daisy, there we go. Okay. Now, because this is going to be static and not dynamic, we can't, I'll tell you what, let's do this in part. So first of all, private, we need somewhere for the control block of the queue from the FreeRTOS documentation, static, and that is of static queue underscore t, and if we hover over that, blah blah blah, some stuff, but basically it's where the state of the queue and so on is stored. So we'll just call that queue control block and we'll default initialize it. And then the way FreeRTOS does this is we now need to declare the memory where the actual data for the queue is held, so all the items and so on that sit within the queue, and it wants that as a byte array, or as bytes at least anyway. So uint 8 is how FreeRTOS wants it, and we'll call it queue storage, and this needs to be big enough to hold that many items with that many bytes per item. But how do we pass that in? Well, unfortunately we can't do it through the constructor because this is statically allocated, compile time allocated. So the only way to do it, unfortunately, is to wrap this whole thing in a template. And how have I done this? Yeah. So we could pass in here size t n items, and then size t item n bytes, and then we've got our array parameters now, which is number of items times the number of bytes per item, and then we default initialize that. So that will create us an array in memory, a chunk of memory on the stack, or static if this is created statically, that is large enough to hold the queue. I'm not quite going to do it this way. I'm going to do it ever so slightly different. We'll pass in the actual type of the item instead, in which case that is no longer item n bytes, it's size of t. So we, the only difference is then that the user can just pass in the type rather than having to pass in size of the type. We just offload some of that work. Okay. xqcreate is slightly different. It's xqcreate static, and it takes the number of items, the number of bytes per item, the storage block, so where we want to actually store the data for the queue, which is queue storage, or if you're inclined to C, we would take the first item and then the address of, you don't necessarily need to do that, doesn't actually change anything here. But if you're used to C, then you would see that a lot, because an array is a pointer. It's the same thing, effectively, underlying. It's not strictly. And then the last parameter we can see here is the actual queue buffer. So that is the control block. And this is a struct. And we want to take the address of the struct. So we pass that in as a pointer. So we have to take the address of that there. So that's our create queue done. VQ delete is still perfectly valid. Create the queue is still perfectly valid. So none of that needs to change. And actually, very little of this needs to change, if anything at all. Apart from, we've got a duplication of data here. What if you passed in a different item number of bytes in the template parameter versus the constructor? So you did something like static queue int 5, and then we say my queue. And then you said, I want the queue to be 20 items long, and each item is one, let's say. And I've just realized that's not item, that's number of items there. Sorry, that's a typo on my part. And items, yeah, I've done it right there. So I want a static queue that holds ints, and I want it to hold 5 of them. And then in the constructor, I've said, I want you to hold 20 of them. Well, all of a sudden we've got some weirdness going on here, and that's, we don't want that. So what we can actually do is this now doesn't take any parameters, because we have n items already available to us as a variable from the template. We don't have item n bytes, but we sort of do. It's size of t. So what we can do here, let's just get rid of that, is create a unique pointer, number of items, and each item is the size of t. And each item is the size of t, and then that will cascade down, because then this calls this with the right numbers replaced. And that is now our static implementation done. This will actually allow you to create this on the stack or statically. What do I mean by that? Well, let's take our definition here. And let's say somewhere in our code, we want a static queue that takes ints and is 5 long. And my queue, and it's default initialized because it now takes no parameters. that will allocate it on the stack. However, we can do that now, I think. Maybe we can't, because that's going to call a function that's only known at runtime. Huh. No, xqcreateStatic, I think you can call statically. There you go, there's one for you to look up then, actually. Are both of these cases valid? If so, well, regardless of if so, so that's one question for down in the comments. The other question is, this is allocated on the stack. So what if now, let's say this is within our Wi-Fi class, and then what we do is in our MQTT class, for example, I'm just writing sudo code here, let's just indent that. We want the receiver or the sender, so let's say this is the sender, this is the receiver, and this is going to take my Q1. Okay, yeah, clearly this isn't going to work, but we'll pass it in through a constructor or something. So this now contains a link to the underlying queue. What happens now when Wi-Fi goes out of scope and we get rid of Wi-Fi at runtime? Well, no problem, you say, because it's a shared pointer, so it's not going to delete the underlying resource. Yes, you're quite correct. But what does the underlying resource use? It uses this. And that's just gone out of scope, because the thing that shared pointer protects is the actual queue hand, the queue itself. It does not protect the storage and the control block. So, how do we overcome this problem? I already think I know how to do it. In fact, I do know how to do it. But I'd be very, very interested to hear what your guys' thoughts are. So that's it for today. We will be, of course, using this messaging interface. It's a nice little wrapper around the FreeRTOS queue that we can use in our C++ way. We can move it, we can pass it around and so on. In fact, actually, there's one thing I haven't done, which is this. So we're getting a unique pointer, and then we're passing it into our queue interface. Yeah. And we actually want to move it. So we will just use standard move. This may well actually be superfluous. We might not need that. But just for clarity, it shouldn't do any harm, but it makes it very clear when we read this that we are moving the pointer. So we are after there, it doesn't exist anymore. So if we then change this to implement a different way, it becomes a bit more clear. So I hope you found that interesting. In between episodes, I'll tidy this up, add some comments, usual stuff. Look forward to hearing your comments. See you in the next one.